Hi, I'm David Norland. I'm a composer for film and television. Come on in and I'll show you around my studio. Come and have a look. Hi, I'm David Norland. I'm a film and television composer. You may know my work if you watch the news every night. ABC's 2020 and Nightline. I do a large amount of music for those programs. And I also work in the film world. I just recently scored My Dinner with Herve for HBO, which is the director Sacha Gervasi's story about the star of Fantasy Island and his life and how it intersected with Sacha Gervasi, the director's life when he was a journalist. I've worked with Sacha since we were kids. The first production that we worked on together was a college production where we did the music for a theatre piece that he was involved in producing. And then I worked on his first documentary, which you may know, Anvil, the story of Anvil. And from then on, we've worked together on all of his projects. I was in bands for a long time. And learned at an early stage how to produce records and how to work a recording studio. And when I came to move into film and TV composition, those skills really helped me in terms of making, you know, the best possible recordings of my work. So here we are in my studio, and I made this studio actually specific to my requirements as a composer. I used to have a studio which was chock-a-block full of gear. I had a lot of analog synths, I had a lot of analog outboard stuff. And while I'm still a real gearhead, I discovered a few years ago that I actually hadn't turned a lot of it on for about 5 years. So I came to the conclusion that I would much rather have a space which was creatively inspiring to me rather than a serious tech space. And what I tried to accomplish was a mixture of both. So I've got the bookcases at both ends. They're actually a terrific acoustic treatment as well. There are bass traps built into the corners behind the fitted walls. All of this is acoustically treated, the fabric walls, the whole nine yards. It's a really good dead sounding room, which I like. I'm really particular about the kinds of mixes that I can take out of a room. The sound of this room is very linear. I have a limited amount of outboard gear, but what I have is pretty carefully selected. Great River Mic Pre's, the Overstayer Stereo VCA, the Overstayer Stereo Bus, which is on loan from those good people. They make the best gear. It's phenomenal. The Mutator is probably, for my money, the best low-pass filter ever made. And then down there, the Drawman 1969 is just still, after all these years, the best front end for plugging a guitar directly into your interface that I know of, basically, if you're gonna go that way rather than miking up an amp. And then the Lucas, Terry Manning makes those out at Compass Point Studios. It's based on a Universal 175. He would hate me saying that. It's not, but it's similar to, and it's one of the best tube compressors that I've ever heard. So while it's not a huge collection of gear, it's all hand-picked and greatly loved. In terms of keyboards, generally speaking, the only synths that I use, if I use synths, are the Juno 106, which is hugely versatile, the SE1, which is like a rack mount, which is a rack-mounted Mini Moog, essentially, and the Teenage Engineering OP1, which is just a lot of fun and strange and weird and super creative to get your hands on. And then everything else happens in the box. I mic up a lot of stuff. I have a collection at the back of the studio, can't see it from here, of decent vintage mics. Record a lot of my own sample libraries. I have a lot of metallic instruments, a lot of stringed instruments. We bow them, we hit them, we record them, we process them, and we build up sample libraries of strange sounds, which I then am able to pull up instead of pulling up a patch on a soft synth. So that's my general setup. So I work in Logic. I've always worked in Logic. I have Pro Tools as well, and I work in Pro Tools sometimes, but my Logic is my principal composition instrument of choice. Well, the piano is my principal composition instrument of choice, but Logic is my principal workstation of choice. And I've been working in Logic since, I don't know if this is right to say, but the first thing I started on was C-Lab Notator and an Akai S950. So I've sort of been following that evolved at a certain point into Logic, and I've been using it from that point, so I've never really seen a need to change. So today we're going to be looking at a session from the score for My Dinner with Herve for one of the cues. And this was a cue that came to me in the middle of the edit process, where they'd cut a rough version of the scene together, and Sasha, the director, came to me and said, we really need something to help navigate the many tonal shifts in this particular scene. And we go from Herve's father. Herve at this point is a young kid living in Paris, and his parents, or his father, is trying to find a cure for him, while his mother is trying to completely live in denial that he has this problem of being born with dwarfism. The father is desperately researching a cure, and we see him in his study poring through books, and his father is a doctor and looking for medical cures that might actually help him grow. And so we start with a bit of a frantic sense of the father's, you know, real intent to help find a cure for his son. And then we move to Herve comes into the room, and the father's mood lightens as he sees his son, and he loves his son. And then the mother comes in, and the tone turns dark, and the mother is saying to the father, here's another sick note that you gave to the school, saying that he didn't have to go to school. He has to go to school. He's not sick. There's nothing wrong. And she stamps. And then she turns on her heel and she storms out. And Herve is sitting there watching. And she picks up his toy train and she smashes it on the floor and then walks past him. And he's left looking, this little kid with these great difficulties, looking at this mother who has essentially abandoned him. So that's a lot of tonal shifts to go through in a scene. And the job of the music is to help us navigate through all of those twists and turns. And this session that I've got up here is the session for that cue. And I'm going to take you through it and show you what I did over the course of putting that cue together. My writing process normally starts just simply sitting, playing the piano, and just seeing if I can bring up in myself and on the piano some kind of emotional feeling that connects to what we're trying to do with the story at this point. And once I've got that, I'll record it very simply, almost like a chorale, and then I may arrange it for strings or for whatever arrangement or orchestration I'm feeling is appropriate for that. Which I'll do in Logic, and I have very simple string templates in Logic, pretty basic, and I'll put it together pretty quickly and get it sounding realistic pretty quickly. And then depending on what the cue needs, I might start building some atmospheres and textures as well. A lot of times I'll work on thematic ideas away from picture. And then when I'm working to picture, I might start by just moving the thematic ideas around, almost like a music editor, and seeing what works and sits against picture well, if you ever conducted that experiment where you just take a number of different pieces of music and put them against a scene, it's astonishing what different pieces of music can bring. But finding something that fits into the world of the story that's being told from the perspective of the director who's telling the story. That's really the key element. And then I'll start if it needs building up, if it needs to be more complicated or more elaborate an arrangement, I'll start building it up and I'll start working with what's happening on screen and beginning to, and quite often the thematic material may recede into the background at that point as I work with textures and as I work with rhythms to emphasize certain things. And here's a particular scene from the HBO film My Dinner with Herve, where Herve is a young kid in post-war Paris. His father is a doctor and is trying to research means of getting Herve to grow, and they've been through a number of very difficult surgical procedures, none of which have been successful, and Herve remains the size that he is. And we come into this particular sequence, we see Herve's father in his study rifling through these research books, medical research books, trying to find something that might lead to a cure. So we need a sense of intensity and franticness. And I accomplish that with a set of ascending trills on solo strings, minor trills, and a pulse in the cellos, and some textures behind and some electronic percussion just sort of ticking away very gently in the background. And then Herve walks into the room. And as soon as the father sees Herve, his mood lifts. This is the kid that he loves and he's doing all this for, and we move into a major key very briefly. And then the mother enters the room, and Herve's mother is in a process of denial. She can't believe that her son is not healthy. She doesn't wish to believe it. She doesn't wish to believe that this is her son, and she essentially is abandoning him. And she comes into the father with a sick note, and she says, this is, you know, here's another, the school are telling me you've given them another sick note, and here it is, and he's not sick. He has to go to school. And she, there's no warmth or forgiveness in her for Herve in any way, shape, or form. And she turns on her heel, and we hear a low note. This is bad news here. And then we hear, as she storms out of the room, the piano tracks her, a piano motif tracks her footsteps, and she picks up, as she passes Herve, she picks up his toy train, she smashes it in front of him, and then walks out, totally abandoning this poor kid. And as she walks out, that's the first time that we really get anything. We get just a hint of Herve's, the theme for Herve's mother, which is a very simple string line. It's just 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, five notes. Just an ascending line on the strings, harmonized with solo strings underneath it. It's actually a strange, it's not a particularly conventional ensemble. It's five violins, six violins, two violas, two cellos, and a contrabass. And it's a fairly closely harmonized arrangement. And behind all of this are textures that I've built. And you'll see here when I talk when I've spoken earlier about that I don't like pulling up pads or keyboard or soft synths to make my textures. What I've done here in terms of the textures, and I'll play this for you, is that I've recorded, I play the flute, and so I've built up some flute textures here, which you can hear coming your way shortly. And so they provide just this suspended chord sitting in the background. And then behind them is, I recorded the OP1, Teenage Engineering OP1, playing some arpeggios, and then ran it through a reverb and just recorded the reverb. And we have this sitting behind it, which provides more depth to the texture. And you actually don't hear the direct signal at all. You're really just hearing the reverb, and that's running through. You may be able to hear a degree of distortion, a little bit of a Leslie simulator, a rotor simulator, and some various other processing. So it has a little bit of grit to it. And then the strings behind that are doing this sort of intense pulse and trills and swelling father's really desperate. He needs a solution to this problem of how to get his son healthy. And we build up, and then, and so if you put it all in together, we get not only all of that, but we also get the depth of the textures behind the strings and some percussion as well, to help with the pulse and to help with the tension. As he gets more and more frantic, and then he sees his son, Herve walks into the room, and we resolve ever so slightly into a major key. And then the mother walks in. And so while there's dialogue, the music sits right back in the background. It's just textures. Little bit of a minor swell on the strings. This is not a good conversation that they're having. And then this is not good. Mother is angry now. She turns on her heel, she walks out, and the piano tracks her foot movement. And as she smashes the train, just a hint of the thematic material. And then, as we cut back to the now, and Herve is in the limo recalling it, we hear this chaos in his head, this emotional chaos produced by his traumatic relationship with his mother when he was a kid and the abandonment. And that chaos is made up of, I actually played that on the flute. It's three different sets of flute trills run through a number of effects, and on its own it sounds something like this. And that's just me with the flute, and I just set up a mic in here and through the good line gear. And I just record it, and my process tends to be that I work in the sequencer, and I have a mic set up, and I record stuff as I go quite a lot. If there's anything that I can actually play, I'll play it, and that'll become part of the session. From that you can see, so I actually had, and I'll play you from before, I actually had the Herve mother theme that we hear at the end there written beforehand, and you can see, look, the way I do it is I actually work and I archive every single day of work, and each day will have a number of different cues that I worked on. So I had this theme, just this for the mother, and my initial version of it was just, I sort of played it a number of different ways, and this was done not to picture, this was just a thematic idea. And so this was the initial writing I did for it before I saw any picture. I'd seen the script. I knew that the mother was a big part of the story in terms of the effect that she'd had on her son. So this is the theme that I wrote. And you can sort of tie it back now to that particular cue in the film. So having scored the actual scene, I just used a fraction of the theme at the end of the cue to give us just a hint and to tie it into the mother as we go through the film. And obviously all of this is programmed strings, you know, all of it has to be programmed with the strings up until we get it all approved. And then at that point we hire the string section and record them. So this is typically what I'll do, is I'll write a number of themes and I'll produce up, not to picture, I'll just produce up the themes with a number of different variations. And so, and then I'll go to Sasha with, you know, probably six or seven themes all produced up like this with different variations. And we listen through them and start putting them to picture and see what fits, you know. what I'm doing musically is all entirely in the service of the storytelling. It's all entirely in the service of the story that the filmmaker is telling. And it doesn't have any use or function or value if it's not in the service of that. So the process of how to come to what this story needs and how to best help tell this story, it's not only at the heart of the process, it's the whole process. You know, you sort of, the making of the music itself is an extension of a much more core function, which is being a brush in the hands of the person who's telling the story, so that they can add dimension and emotion, and also sometimes music fulfills a number of different functions. It can tell the audience something that they don't know that they need to know, that's not happening on screen. Generally speaking, a good rule of thumb is if it's being done by what's happening on screen, it doesn't need music to do it, right? Music is only useful insofar as it advances the story in a way that's not happening on the screen. So my thought is that as a film and television composer, your principal skill, actually, you sort of, obviously you have to be able to make the music, but the principal skill is as a storyteller. And as a storyteller who is working as an adjunct to another storyteller, using your craft to help tell their story. So I was always in bands at school, and I was in all kinds of bands. I was in rock bands, I was in jazz bands, I played jazz flute, I was a chorister, I was a boy treble, I sang with a touring group of singers who sang Elizabethan church music in cathedrals around England. So I always made music as a kid. I had piano lessons very early. My folks had a piano at home, and they were both musicians of one form or another. And from a very early stage, I just used to sit at the piano like for hours, just noodling and putting ideas together, and you know, my own sort of weird abstract 6-year-old kind of musical ideas. And so that was always in my DNA. I sang in choral groups. I sang in a choral group that toured around England, singing medieval church music. I was in jazz band at school. I was in rock bands, and all the time I was writing music. And you know, a lot of it was not very original to start with, but you know, at that age, I guess you perhaps don't expect that. But more than anything, it was, you know, I was fascinated by just doing it. It was really all I wanted to do. I was at boarding school, and in my room at school, I had a record player and a guitar, and I would sit and play along with Bowie records and learn the guitar parts. And I was always interested in how those records were put together, and more than just the guitar. What were the drums doing? What were the keyboards doing? What was the bass doing? How is the thing structured? Why did it sound the way it did? And that was much more fascinating to me than Latin or you know, history was pretty interesting, but you know, an English literature kind of, those things were interesting, but anything else was not that interesting. I had a great music teacher who was very forward-looking in terms of how he understood music. And one day he sat down at the piano and he put his foot on the sustain pedal, and then he just leant on all the keys like that, on all of them. And then we just sat there and listened to this sound just drift away. And you know, I thought it was okay. I wasn't that impressed. He said, one day you'll understand why that's so amazing. And he was absolutely right. I was in bands when I came out of school. I knew I just wanted to make music, and the way I knew how to do that was to be in bands. So I was always in bands, had record deals, lost record deals, you know. But the great thing about it was it gave me access to these great recording studios and equipment, and I would just hire like the latest keyboard technology and sit at home, you know, and just program it and learn how to use it, and what could I make with this. And from there, it was a pretty straight, I mean, it wasn't a straight line in terms of obviously career ups and downs, but in terms of my intent, you know, I was always just going to sit and make music and try and make the most forward-looking music that I could find. And so I was in bands for a long time. I had a deal with Maverick in a band called Solar Twins, which I wrote and produced, which got a lot of critical acclaim, but zero record sales. And from that point onwards, we had a great A&R person called Jason Bentley, who is head of music at KCRW now, and he, through his endorsement and his help and influence, people started asking me to do little pieces of work for advertising and for promos and things like that. And I ended up doing a lot of car adverts, and I really liked them. I really enjoyed it because the production values were really strong and they wanted really inventive music from me. And then my old school friend, Sacha Gervasi, who I'd been in a band with when we were at school together, was making the move from being a writer to being a writer-director, and had put together this fabulous rock documentary about Anvil, the heavy metal band. And he needed an ambient score to set against the metal, and he asked me to do music for it. And that film became very successful for a documentary and won a lot of acclaim. And we've been working together on his films ever since. One of the great things about working with Sacha Gervasi is that we know each other well enough and have been working together long enough that I get to see a project in its script stage, and I get to start thinking about the music and working on ideas even at that point, long before a frame of film has been shot. And while a lot of that music that I write early on doesn't make it into the final film, sometimes it does. And what happens is, when at the beginning of the edit we first start putting music to picture to see if there's anything there that works, most of it falls out. But in the process of falling out, it tells us, essentially, we talk about it and we find out why it didn't work and what starts the dialogue between me and Sasha, which I think for me is the core skill for a film and TV composer. I think there are a lot of people coming out of conservatories who can effectively, who can write fabulous music, but it's within the sort of parameters of doing that to serve a storyteller's vision and finding the way to communicate and be communicated with the storyteller so that your music can do for their story what they want it to do and what that story needs. That's the core skill, I think. And so it's really, it's a people thing as much as it is a music thing. And working with Sasha, so I have this body of music that I've already written, sometimes it gets temped in during the rough cut, and sometimes it sticks. And I keep writing all the way through. I keep writing, and playing him stuff and, getting sent picture and working on specific scenes. And then quite often, if I write a piece of music for one scene, if it doesn't work there, sometimes you come back the next week and find that it's been put in somewhere else and it's worked really well there. And so it's an imprecise process. It's what it absolutely and exactly isn't is, here's a film, here's 90 minutes that needs music, a blank canvas, fill it. That's not how we work. How we work is this ongoing creative dialogue whereby the music germinates at the same time as the edit of the film is germinating. When I work with Sasha, I sometimes have a little satellite studio up near the edit room where he's working, so I can work in close proximity with the edit. And sometimes I'll work here at my studio, and I move back and forward between the two. Sometimes we're on a tight deadline and things need to move back and forth between composer and edit really quickly for Sasha to be able to give feedback and get it into the, and me to address the notes and get it back into the edit, in a matter of sometimes not even hours, but minutes. And when we're working on that kind of deadline, it's super helpful, actually, just the physical proximity. And when I do that, I actually just take a laptop studio, I work in Logic, and my setup is duplicated between the Mac Pro, that's my main machine, the MacBook Pro, which is the satellite machine. And so I can swap sessions backwards and forwards really quickly between them without, the session wondering, where all my samples are or anything like that. So this cue is at the end of the film, and without giving too much away, it's a big emotional moment, and we reprise this viola theme, which is descending sevenths. And I recorded the viola in my studio, and the sound was a bit cold. And yet here we have now in this version of it, which is the version from the film, there's so much soul in that sound, viola played high up. And I took the initial recording and I needed to warm it up, but I needed to warm it up without losing any of the sort of the, you know, we can hear a little bit of the scrape on the top of the strings. And so I needed to warm it up without losing any of that kind of fragility. So I needed to warm it up, but I needed to not lose the fragility and the intimacy of really being able to hear the bow on the string. And really, I wanted it to sound fragile. And that was also Sasha's, the director's, intent for this, was that it really needed to sound fragile, because these were really fragile, powerful feelings that we're evoking. And the initial recording just sounded cold, it sounded a bit small. And this overstayer box here, the stereo VCA, it's awesome because it has this harmonic, I don't want to say it's a harmonic synthesizer, it amplifies, I think, as I understand it, the even harmonics. It really warms things up. And it also has a nice high shelf here, really sweet sounding. And with the judicious combination of both of those, I was able to get the warmth and the body that I wanted, but also just to emphasize that beautiful sound of the bow, that fragility over the top. And that's the version that ended up in the film. So there it is. Don't stint on the gear, people. You don't need a lot of it. You don't need a lot of it, but what you have, you know, make it good. Make it good. Get really good quality stuff, because it really helps. You know, we are making recordings here. While a lot of the writing and the initial conceptualizing takes place, you know, in the programmed realm, eventually we're recording people playing music, and in order to do that, you know, it's good to have really good gear. I don't have a huge amount these days, but what I have is really good, and that makes a difference. And in fact, actually, I have some great microphones for when we record in here. I tend to record in the control room, in here, right here, with headphones on, and I've recorded strings in here, and they sound great. I have some decent microphones over there. I've got a couple of those nice original AKG 414s with the gold sputtered brass capsule. Those are really nice. You know, some old Neumanns. And those things make a real difference, even when I do a lot of recording just here, it's just setting up a mic and recording stuff. And it really helps to have good gear in order to do that. Thanks for coming by my studio. My Dinner with Herve is out on HBO. It's airing now. I hope you enjoy it, and thanks for coming by.